Hi DIYers, Sterling with Alarm Grid here. Today we're going to show you how to program a Honeywell 5809 wireless heat detector. You can see that, well, I don't know if you can read this, but this is a fixed heat and rate of rise heat detector. What that means is this device will activate any temperature over 135. As well, it will activate if the temperature in the room advances 15 degrees or more in a minute. That's the rate of rise action. So it gives you better heat detection than just a fixed heat detector only, because you don't have to wait until it gets to 135 in the room. If it's beginning to get that hot in the room, you can get the activation even before it hits 135, and therefore we've alerted everyone in the home and even to the central station that there's a fire emergency. And of course, when seconds are critical in terms of getting response to the property, that difference in having that rate of rise could be very important. This sensor is consisting of a back plate or a mounting plate. You've got your screw holes, and this fixes to the ceiling or to the wall. And then you have your mechanical heat detector. On the back side here, we have our antenna for our wireless transmitter, which the circuitry lives within this plastic piece. We have our battery holster at the bottom. We have our RF test button, and we have our tamper switch, which when the unit's closed down, the tamper is held down and indicating everything is good. So to power this device up, we need to insert our battery. We have a positive and a negative. So we line up our CR123A battery, which is the battery that we've used in a lot of our sensors so far. We make sure that positive is positive, negative is negative, and we now have power to this unit. I want to point out that the fixed temperature 135 degree heat detector is a mechanical heat detector. You have this disc. Be very careful when touching this device that we don't bend or damage this disc. If this unit is mounted and it does exceed 135 degrees, this unit will pop down, which activates the device. And it is a one-time only use device if the fixed heat is ever activated. So if you use the rate of rise and the alarm goes off, but it never gets to 135, then the device can simply be reset by disarming the system and it's still a working device. As soon as you have a temperature above 135 and this disc pops out, you would have to physically replace this device with a new 5809 heat detector. So heat detectors are great for areas where you may have dust or smoke or something that would activate a smoke detector, in which case you don't want false alarms all the time. The heat detector would only sound the alarm when it's a real fire emergency and it's getting above that 135 degree temperature, or the heat is rising in the room fast enough to trigger the rate of rise. So now that we know how the 5809 works, we're gonna show you how to program it. As with all Honeywell sensors, we need the seven digit serial number, which starts with an A for alpha, and that serial number is displayed on two spots for this device, and that's what we're gonna use to program the device. To program, we go into Security, More, Tools, and from there we can enter our installer code. 4112 is our installer code, and we can now enter the system programming. By hitting the program button, we see that the panel's in system programming by this yellow horizontal bar at the top. That doesn't mean the panel's processing any programming commands at this time. It just means that we're in the programming of the system. Next, we go to zones, and we highlight and hit the down arrow. As you can see, there are many zones available with this panel. In fact, up to 64 wireless zones. I should say 63 because zone one is a hardwired zone. But if we go and we choose the next available new zone in our slot of zones, would be zone 14. We highlight it to be blue, and we can then hit edit. And once we hit edit, we're ready to enroll our device. These are all of the questions we need to answer to set up our 5809 wireless heat detector. First thing we want to do is activate the serial number, or learn in the serial number. So there's two options. One is to type it in. The other one is to hit the RF test button three times, which will activate the device. We have to activate three times for the sensor to be enrolled. So we're going to do it with the test button. So we press and release. And on these heat detectors, sometimes you gotta press a few more times than you would expect. It should be 3 activations. And actually, it's working pretty well right now. I pressed the button once, we heard the beep. We pressed the button twice, we heard the double beep, and we saw that the serial number enrolled. Pressing the third time actually keys it in and locks in the parameters. So we have our 0249918 serial number matches our sticker. The panel auto detects and learns in loop number 1, which is the proper loop number for this device. And we just have to select our device type. When we go into device type, the default is new. Any zone set to new will not activate the system. Once we select what it is, then we get a response type and the sensor will activate. With most devices, once you go in, once we go into our response type selection, you typically have multiple options to choose from. With this device, it's really only one option: fire, no verification. That just means when the alarm is triggered, it sends a fire alarm through to the central station if alarm report is set to yes. If we didn't want this device to do anything but sound the local sounder at the system, we could select alarm report no. In our case, we do want the sounder and the signal to go to the central station, so we're gonna do alarm report yes. You don't ever want to have chime turned on for a smoke or a heat. It wouldn't do anything. There's no reason to have it chimed. And also, supervision should always be supervised, especially with life safety devices. Supervised means that this system will look for this device and all devices that are programmed in every 12 hours. If this device doesn't give a proper check back to the panel, a supervision trouble would show up for zone 14, and that would indicate that we're either too far from the panel, or the sensor's gone bad for some reason, or there's some sort of interference preventing this sensor from talking to this system, and it would give you a supervision trouble so you could address the issue in advance of when you need this sensor to activate. So now that we have it in there, we can save it. If you noticed, we did not select the zone descriptor 1 or 2. In this case, this is going to be the only heat sensor that we use in the house, so we could leave it just with heat sensor only. We're going to install this in the garage, though.
Gallery. Garage.
So we hit the G, and then we hit the down arrow, which is the next available G word, which happened to be garage. And now we have that better designator. You know, I may know that my only heat detector is in the garage, but if I had a family member staying with me or a friend, or you know, the cleaning lady activated it or heard the alarm go off, by putting this word in there, whoever hears the alarm or sees the panel indication, they would know better where the emergency is occurring, and they would know, okay, it's in the garage, I gotta be careful and go, you know, get outside of the garage and make sure that no one's in there. So now that all that's set, we can exit to the home screen. Before we finalize the exiting out, I'm going to go ahead and close up my sensor so I don't have a tamper trouble when I come out of programming. So by installing the sensor, you can see it's a slight clockwise twist, locks it into place, and the sensor is held up now. So if this was mounted, it would not fall out, and we're good to go. And when we come out to the programming screen, our sensor, to verify it works, we can cause a tamper. So if we twist counterclockwise, the panel will start to beep and cause a tamper trouble. You can see at the top, zone trouble chime. It actually says tamper. So you can hear what I'm saying. I'm just hitting the button. There's still the tamper because it's still open. And you have tamper 14 garage heat sensor with an indication of fire. So you would know that means somehow someone's messing with our sensor in the garage. We better go close it up. By closing it up and disarming the system, it would clear off the tamper. While we have it tampered, I'm gonna go ahead and test. There's an RF test button, this little black push button, and pressing and holding that's gonna cause a fire alarm. And we're gonna hear how the sensor works when activated. So we're gonna press and hold the button. We get the fire alarm tone.
Disarmed, ready to arm. Check zone.
And audibly, that gives a different sounder than a burglary alarm. You heard the beep, 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 and then the pause, and then the beep, beep, beep. That's an industry standard fire alarm tone. It's called a temporal sounder. And what that does, instead of the steady burglary alarm sounder, if you were in the house and audibly you heard that, you would be alerted that it's not a criminal entering the home unannounced. In fact, it's a fire alarm emergency. We better get outside of the house and clear everybody out. So that verifies that we've properly enrolled our 5809, and therefore we can close it back up, disarm the system, and we're back to ready to arm, and we have successfully programmed and tested our 5809 wireless heat detector. We hope this video has been helpful. We invite you to subscribe to our channel, and if you have any questions about your L5200 Lynx Touch panel or your wireless 5809 heat detector, please do email us support@alarmgrid.com.